This webinar series presents key findings from the School Nutrition and Meal Cost Study. This webinar focuses on whether school lunches met the updated nutrition standards and the nutritional quality of the lunches. The first webinar in the series provides an overview of the study, and four other webinars present key findings related to school meal program operations, school meal costs and revenues, dietary intakes of school meal participants and non-participants, and satisfaction with school meals and plate waste. Starting in school year 2012-13, the school meal programs began to undergo widespread changes, including updated nutrition standards for meals, additional lunch reimbursement for meals that met the standards, and rules affecting the price charged for full-price lunches. The School Nutrition and Meal Cost Study was the first comprehensive national assessment of the programs since these major reforms began. The study collected data in school year 2014-15, which was the first year that school meals had to meet all of the updated nutrition standards. As part of the study, school nutrition managers completed a menu survey for one school week. The menu survey collected detailed information about the foods provided to students in reimbursable meals each day, including food descriptions, portion sizes, and other information needed to assess the food and nutrient content of the meals. The final sample included more than 1,200 schools and 5,700 daily lunch menus. Data were also collected and analyzed for school breakfast, but this webinar focuses on lunches. The findings described in this webinar are based on two analyses, one that estimated the percentage of daily and weekly lunch menus that met the updated nutrition standards, and another that examined the nutritional quality of the lunches using the Healthy Eating Index 2010. First, we'll look at the extent to which school lunches met the updated nutrition standards. The updated nutrition standards were designed to better reflect the dietary guidelines for Americans and improve the nutritional quality of school meals. The standards include daily and weekly meal pattern requirements that specify minimum amounts of food to be offered each day and over the course of the week, for example, for fruits, vegetables, and grains. They also set restrictions on the types of foods allowed in lunches, for example, the types of milk allowed, and requiring that all grains be whole grain rich. And lastly, they include dietary specifications that set minimum and maximum calorie levels and limits on saturated fat and sodium. The findings presented in this webinar focus on compliance with a subset of the requirements for lunches. This slide shows the percentage of daily lunch menus across all schools that met daily meal pattern requirements. All lunch menus met the requirement for milk, and 95% met the requirement for fruits. 91% of lunch menus met the daily requirement for meats and meat alternates, while about 80% met the requirement for vegetables and grains. 91% of menus offered only allowed types of milk, which included fat-free milk and unflavored low-fat milk. After these data were collected, USDA provided schools with flexibility in meeting the milk requirement by allowing flavored low-fat milk. If this flexibility had been in place in 2014-15, virtually all daily lunch menus would have met this requirement. Virtually all weekly lunch menus met the weekly requirement for milk, and 92% met the requirement for fruits. Just under 80% of menus met the weekly vegetables requirement. The weekly requirements for meats and meat alternates and grains were more challenging to meet, and this was particularly true for middle and high schools. Depending on the ages of the students served, schools may have to offer more than the daily minimum amounts required for grains and meat alternates on some days in order to meet the associated weekly requirements. Overall, 58% of weekly lunch menus met the requirement for meats and meat alternates, and just under half met the requirement for grains. Between 92 and 95% of weekly lunch menus met the weekly requirements for dark green, starchy, red and orange, and other vegetables. A smaller proportion of weekly menus, 79%, met the weekly requirement for legumes. 27% of weekly lunch menus offered only whole grain-rich items. This requirement took effect for the first time in school year 2014-15 when data for the study were collected. However, schools may have had a waiver for meeting this requirement, instead had to meet a relaxed requirement that at least half of the grains were whole grain rich. The majority, or 87%, of weekly lunch menus met this relaxed requirement for whole grains. On average, over the week, 93% of lunch menus complied with the limit on saturated fat. 72% of lunch menus complied with the limit on sodium that was specified in the first target. The percentage of weekly lunch menus that met the calorie specifications was lower at 41%, meaning less than half of weekly menus had an average calorie level that fell within the specified calorie range, although these findings did vary by school type. On average over the week, 47% of lunch menus in elementary schools and 42% in middle schools had calorie levels that fell within the specified range, compared with only 21% of lunch menus in high schools. Menus that did not meet the specified calorie range either fell below the minimum calorie level or exceeded the maximum calorie level, which are shown here in the top and bottom portions of each bar. For elementary and middle schools, it was more common for lunch menus to exceed the maximum calorie level than to fall below the minimum calorie level. The pattern was reversed for high schools, where it was more common for menus to fall below the minimum calorie level than to exceed the maximum. Next, we'll look at findings from a separate analysis that examined the nutritional quality of school lunches before and after the updated nutrition standards were in place. We used the Healthy Eating Index, or HEI 2010, to examine the nutritional quality of school lunches. The HEI 2010 assigns scores to lunches based on consistency with key recommendations of the Dietary Guidelines for Americans. This includes scores for 9 adequacy components, which reflect key food groups such as fruits, vegetables, dairy, and whole grains, 3 moderation components, which focus on limiting sodium, empty calories, and refined grains, and a total score that measures overall nutritional quality. HEI scores are expressed as a percentage of a maximum possible score, and scores closer to 100% indicate lunches of higher nutritional quality. This figure shows total HEI 2010 scores for lunches before the updated standards were in place in school year 2009-10 and after the updated standards were in place in 2014-15. The total HEI score for lunches increased significantly between the 2 points in time, from 58% of the maximum to 82% after the updated standards were implemented. This indicates that the updated standards improved the nutritional quality of school lunches and made them more consistent with the dietary guidelines, which is what they were intended to do. The large increase in the total HEI score was driven by increases in scores for a number of the adequacy components included in the HEI. As shown here in red, scores for 7 of the 9 adequacy components in the HEI increased significantly after the updated standards were in place. Remember, scores closer to 100% indicate higher nutritional quality. As shown on the left side, the largest increases were for whole grains, greens and beans, and total fruit. For the remaining adequacy components, scores either increased slightly or stayed relatively constant over time. For school year 2014-15, you'll see that the scores for whole grains, total fruit, and whole fruit increased to 95% or more of the maximum scores, indicating that the concentrations of these components in school lunches were very consistent with the recommendations in the dietary guidelines. There were also significant improvements in the scores for the moderation components. For these components, higher scores mean lower concentrations of refined grains, empty calories, and sodium in school lunches. Scores for all 3 of these components increased significantly between school year 2009-10 and school year 2014-15, meaning that the concentrations of refined grains, empty calories, and sodium decreased over time, making the lunches healthier. Sodium scores at both points in time were rather low in relation to the maximum score. However, the score for sodium almost tripled, which reflects a substantial improvement in the sodium content of lunches after the first sodium target was in effect. More information on these findings, as well as findings for other study objectives, can be accessed on FNS's website using the link shown here. This includes study reports, infographics, and additional webinars, including one that provides additional details on the methods used to assess compliance with the nutrition standards.